God, we just acknowledge that your word is real. God, your word is true. God, that your word changes everything. And I pray tonight, I don't even know what I was going to talk about. Lord, your presence is in this place. I just pray that it's your word, that it's your spirit. God, it's your move in our hearts that speaks into our life, that speaks into our very existence of what you want and what you will for us tonight. So God, we come before you, and Lord, we open our hearts, we open our ears to hear and to receive that which you want us tonight to grab a hold of in your life, in our lives, so that we walk out of this place different than what we came in with, that we'd walk out of this place one step closer on that journey to becoming more like Jesus in our lives. So Father, we give you that praise as we ask you'd speak to us. All that happens in our lives, we say, goes to your glory, to your honor, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Man, they're good. You just take your seats for a moment. You guys can be dismissed. You want a chair? I told him to bring me a chair out tonight. Not because I'm tired. You know, I talk fast. I had our children's pastor, Pastor Mondo, was just saying like, man, Pastor Luke, you can go so deep that it's hard for me to even turn to the Bible because I don't want to miss anything. And I had this plan. I had this message all prepped out. You know, my wife, my beautiful wife, she was asking me this whole week. She's like, babe, what are you going to talk about? And I'm like, oh, I got it all planned out. I'm ready for it. I know God's got something great. When I showed up this morning, I kind of looked at where we were going in the next couple of weeks. And I just felt like God was saying, you know, that's not the time. It's not the place. I'm going to do something different. And I thought, oh, cool. I don't know what everybody's asking me like this today, all day. What are you going to talk about? I'm like, I have no clue. I have no idea. I'm like reading my Bible, like, Lord, Spirit, I'm looking for old messages. What can I recycle and rechange and kind of change the vocabulary? And I just felt like God just said, you know what? Why don't we just talk a little bit tonight? Why don't we just study the Bible a little bit, you know? And so I just told him, I said, you know what? Bring me a chair out. I'll get my little pub table. I made this. It's cool, huh? I made that. Get my little pub table. Let's just talk. Can we just do that? I think it's a little bit more anointed when Elijah plays too, so that's why I told him to stay. You know, I was thinking as I was kind of in a panic today about what God wanted to speak into our lives. And I say our lives because ultimately, every time I come up here, I don't want to just tell you what the Bible says about something. I always tell people, you know, I just preach to myself. Whatever I'm dealing with, I think I'm just kind of an average human being. I don't think I'm anything special. I don't think that there's anything real unique about me. I'm just like you, trying to figure life out one day at a time. I got kids that they don't look like blessings from God every day. Sometimes I kind of wonder about that. You know, my wife and I, we fight, we argue. We got problems just like everybody else got problems, and we got high days and we got low days. And so I just was asking God, God, would you speak to me? In my life, that perhaps I could just share with what I could speak to them. And so I just thought, let's just do this. Let's look at what God has. And what I just want to share with you today, as I was just kind of spending some time with God, what God was speaking to me, and I think he wants to speak to us. And so I don't ever do this. Pastor Dan, you know, I spent a lot of time in preparation. As people always like, man, Pastor Luke, how do you do it without notes? The secret is like 3 weeks of preparation and memorization. That's really how you do it. So today, with about 45 minutes of Spirit of God time, we're going through this together. And I was thinking about this, and I wanted to ask this question to set off tonight. Have you ever looked at some place in your life, at some position, at some point in your life, and just look back and seen, man, there was so much potential that I didn't see, that if I would have just opened my eyes to what I could have been, that could have been so much better than it really was. You know, I have this little paper on my wall. Paper costs a lot of money. That paper's my degree from California Baptist University. I know I got any CBU students, alumni, any of y'all, any of my Lancers in this place. All right, a couple of you. Praise God. I got this really cool, really expensive piece of paper on my wall that says that I graduated from a university. Truth be told, it wasn't really that hard for me. I don't know. I just studying, education, reading, it just kind of comes natural. I consider myself a lifelong student. I'm not very old. I haven't lived a lot of life, but I think it's one of my passions and visions in life is to always continue my pursuit of deeper understanding and a deeper knowledge. And I remember when the time came for graduation and the time came to see what my graduation was going to be, my wife, she got this little golden sticker on her degree. And it said cum laude, and it meant with honors. And it was such a cool honor. I mean, she got this little ribbon that she got to wear as a special standout from everybody. And I was like, man, how cool is that? And then I looked at my report in college, and I looked at my GPA, grade point average, and my GPA was 0.02 points away from that little gold sticker and that little gold ribbon. And I looked back at that and I said, gosh, I did the bare minimum for me to get by. I spent more time playing video games in college in my 20s, eating hamburgers and drinking monster drinks, staying up till 3 in the morning than I did applying myself. If I would have just given myself just a little bit more, I could have had that golden sticker. What did it mean? Nothing. But there was more potential. I think life sometimes is like that. You know, our lives are super short. When you look at parenting, maybe you've grown up and you, or your kids have grown up and you look back and you say, God, there was so much potential if I just would have paid a little bit more attention to my kids. Maybe you look at your career and you say, man, there's just so much potential if I could just dedicate a little bit more time. You look at your finances or your future, you say, I just feel like there's so much that could happen if I would just do something bigger with it. But life goes on and one day turns to the next day and the next day turns into the next day and we just kind of go on with life. There's a lot of unfulfilled potentials in life. And I think one of the greatest things is I was asking God, what do you want to speak to my life about? Is the subject of the unfulfilled potential in our lives, specifically speaking to our walks with God. You know, I think if there's one thing that I could say is my life's mission in this calling of ministry, whatever that is, pastoring, preaching, and teaching, it's not to be a good speaker, it's not to be a good communicator, it's not to be a dynamic leader, it's not to do any of that stuff. That's cool, that's great. When a man who I greatly respected asked me, what is it that you want to do with your life? I just simply said, I want to help people recognize their potential in Christ. Because even though life may not seem like it in the moment, right now, it may not seem like anything's going in your favor. It may not seem like there's anything happening that's significant or that's going to really bring you leaps and bounds to a new place in life. There's so much potential in our relationships with God that I think we can miss out on it because we just don't want to step out or we don't know what to do in the future. And God took me to a really interesting story. Are you guys familiar with the story of the promised land? Does anybody know what the promised land is? Can I see so that you know what the promised land is? Now, I don't want to call you out and I don't want to single you out, but is there any of you in this place? And it's super cool to be this way. I'm actually more happy about you than the people that know about the story. Are there any of you that are really kind of unfamiliar, vague about the promised land? Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's cool. I'd hope you raise your hand because I think you are awesome. I just want you to know that because it's a major step for you to even be here right now. And I just want you to know that's super cool. See, there's a story of a man by the name of Abraham. And Abraham, God called him out and he said, I'm going to take you to a place where I'm going to make a great nation out of you. This Abraham had no kids. He had no propensity to have children. He was old. Abraham followed God. He just simply followed God. He never really saw the fulfillment of that promise. At the end of his life, he died. He didn't have any land to his name, and he had a son, and his son went on and tried to continue in his dad's legacy, and his son had some kids, and his son's son had a bunch of sons, as It generally happens in the stories, right? So-and-so, if you think about the Bible, there's probably, you know that the Bible has a lot about so-and-so begot so-and-so begot so-and-so, and we're like, what does that mean? Time progressed, and there was this whole generation of people, thousands, millions of people that were at the present enslaved in Egypt, and God, through the story of Moses and the Ten Commandments, made me know that story. He took them out of Egypt, and we only kind of focus on the exodus of Egypt. Well, the ultimate destination from Egypt was to this place, the Promised Land, where we call Israel today. And as they entered the Promised Land, there was this man by the name of Joshua who was leading all these people to the conquest of this Promised Land. There was people living there, and God said, these people have turned their hearts against me. They had their chance long ago with my servant Abraham, and they just didn't do that. And now I'm going to give you this land. And so they went through a series of conquests. And it's kind of a weird story because in our society, it's not really cool to go take somebody else's land and call it your own. We don't view favorably at that. But you know, the world was really different 5,000 years ago. So they were conquesting what we would call Israel. And there's this really interesting story, which I want you to go with me to in Joshua, the 18th chapter. There's this really interesting story that God was speaking to my heart as I was reading through the story. Whenever I don't know what to read, I kind of go through the story because there's so many lessons about this. And Joshua was speaking to the people. See, they had all gathered together in Joshua chapter number 18, verse number 1. I totally can't read that confidence monitor. Joshua, just we were trying something out. And I was like, I told my guy, Stephen, like, that's super cool, but that is way too small. He's like going to be super bummed about that. Joshua 18, chapter 18, verse number 1. Now the whole congregation, like, what is that? The whole church? What is the congregation? The whole gathering of people. Gathered together at Shiloh. And at this time, Shiloh was like the religious capital of these people. That's where they ended up setting up what we would call the tabernacle or the temporary temple in which the presence of God physically and literally dwelt in on earth. His presence was there, and they would go and they would congregate and they would journey to Shiloh, the city. So they all gathered to this real holy city, Shiloh. And they set up the tabernacle of meeting there. And that's this temporary dwelling place of God until Solomon built this temple. But there remained among the children of Israel seven tribes, seven family groups, who had not yet received their inheritance, their land. You see, a couple of chapters early in Joshua, the 13th chapter, Joshua had laid out, okay, from this family group, Benjamin, this is where you're going to live. This is your geographic area. Manasseh, this is your geographic area. And Simeon, those of you who are the family of Simeon, this is where you guys are going to live. And all the different tribes, they laid out the borders and they laid out what the promised land is going to look like. But it says here, a while after that had all been done, now they gather back to this holy city. And there are seven people out of the 12 families or tribes of Israel, and which had not yet received this. They hadn't yet conquered this. They hadn't yet moved into this promised land. They were still kind of everywhere. But I thought it was really interesting what it said. It said, verse number one, it goes back and it says that there was a tabernacle, and they set up this tabernacle of meeting, and the land was subdued, which meant that the land was under their control. But yet there were people who had not yet gone out and gotten their inheritance. They hadn't yet gone out and grabbed the position. You could even say it like this. They hadn't yet gone out and grabbed God's promise for their life. And he goes on, and Joshua says this, and I think this is where God just checked my heart today. Just nailed my feet to the ground. Joshua says to the children of Israel, how long will you neglect to go and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers has given to you? Some translations will go in far and say, how long will you wait? How long are you going to wait to possess what God has promised you to do? And I started thinking about that. Started asking myself, I mean, the author right here, what we read of Joshua said that Israel was, or the promised land that we would see as Israel today, was under their control. And yet they hadn't gone out. And so you wonder, okay, were they sitting around and just waiting for God to to call them out of their area, out of Shiloh, out of wherever they were living, and say, okay, the time is now. I've built for you a home. I've built for you a city. I've built for you a place. And then they could go. I think they knew better than that, because they knew that they had to work for Jericho. They knew that they had to work from city to city, that God had a promise, but with God's promise, with his promise, there was immense potentials for what could be in the promises of God. But they knew that the only way that they would receive God's promise is to go out and do something with God's promise. And so I think that this was a people group that knew that when they wanted to step out, when they wanted to fulfill, when they saw the potential of God's promise, they knew that they would have to go out and get it. But Joshua says, how long? How long are you going to neglect the very fact that God has something for you? Potential. But yet you're not going and getting it. You're not going and getting it. And God just put on my heart, there are so many potentials in the promises of God. Yet many of the potentials in the promises of God can only be realized by acting in faith. And so we sit and we want God to move in our lives, and I want God to do something new, and I want God to do something mighty, and I want God to do something fresh in my life. And so I say, God, I'm standing on your promise and I'm waiting on your promise. I just know you're going to do something for me, and I know you're going to do something through me, and I know you're moving, and I'm so glad and I'm so grateful. But as I was reading that, God just spoke to me and he said, Luke, how long are you going to wait for the promise to be fulfilled? How long are you going to neglect the very fact that there are potentials in your life that have not yet been realized and that will never be realized unless you step out in faith? You see, conquering a land, that was a lot of work. Even if God was behind them, that meant swords and spears and bloodshed and strategy and battles and fights and hardship and turmoil and time. It meant a cost. See, the promises of God would cost these people something in their lives. Some of them, it would cost them their lives to see the potential really be realized. And the question I ask is, were they sitting around waiting for God to bring the promises? No, I think they knew that. I think they knew at this point that they needed to go out and get it. I think that they weren't really willing to pay that price. They weren't really ready to step out in faith without a net underneath them. They weren't ready to do something that they've never done before. They weren't ready to go that further step. Israel had already been subdued. There was already a religious capital set up. I'm comfortable. I'm good. This is okay. I'm not a slave in Egypt anymore. I've got food on the table. My kids are growing up. You know, we're farming and we're developing the land. God says, there's so much unrealized, unfulfilled potential in this current situation. And he says, how long are you going to live in unfulfilled potential? And I just felt God's presence in my heart saying, there's a lot of people tonight. There's a lot of you in this room tonight. That's why I have my friend Elijah just flowing behind me tonight. That there's so much potential in your life. There's so much that God wants to do in your life. There's more potential in this room than we even know. Paul the Apostle tells us in Ephesians, the third chapter, that God is the God who could do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think. And there's so much potential in this room. The question is, what are the things that you're waiting on God for in your life? What is it in your life that you're waiting on God for? Did you felt God say, you know, I'm going to do something in your life. There's some potential that I want you just to see. I want you to catch a glimmer of what it is that I want to take you to. And you saw that glimmer, you saw that hope, you saw this presence, and you felt that. Maybe it's your children. Maybe it's your ministry coming out of your heart. Maybe it's a future and an existence with God. Maybe it's a career. Maybe it's a fulfillment. Maybe it's an emotional situation or an emotional level that you say, I just know that God's going to get me here and get me through this and get me past this. And I'm just waiting. What is it in your life that you're waiting for God to do something in your life? But then the question I ask that goes one step further than that, as you think about that in your life, what is it that you're waiting on God for? Is what are you doing to reach that promise? What are you doing to reach that potential? Because I think a lot of times what happens is we just want God to bring it to us. And you know, God pursues us like he did tonight, like we experienced his presence. We say, God, you got a promise, and I'm just going to patiently sit and wait for it to happen. But the question I ask you, the question I ask me, is what are you doing to reach the potential of God's promise in your life? Because you know the story of the Bible from the beginning to the end, if you really look at it, it's a narrative of people. It's a collective story of people. It's a people that had a word from God and did something with that word. And Jesus likens our life to a story he tells in Luke, the 18th chapter. You can go there if you'd like. Luke chapter 18. I'll pause for dynamic effect so that you can turn there. Since I go too fast. Am I going slow enough today? Luke chapter 18. Jesus gives us this parable, and I think he likens our life to this. I think this is the summation of his desire for the people who follow him. Verse number one, Jesus says this. He spoke a parable to them, and I love this. I read one commentator said it like this. He said, in this parable, the key is in the door lock already. Like, you don't have to wonder what Jesus is talking about. In this, Jesus left the key in the door for you to turn the knob and open the door. Jesus spoke a parable to them that they, here it is, that they always ought to pray and not lose heart. But look at this parable that Jesus tells. He says that there was a certain city, there was a judge who did not fear God and fear men. What that means is he was corrupt. He was just a corrupted judge. In this certain city, this judge did not fear God and he did not regard men. And there was a widow in that city. She had nothing. Widows had nothing to their name. If your husband died, you didn't get his money, you didn't get his inheritance, you didn't get his land, you didn't get his property, it went to his brother or it went to your son. It didn't go to you. Sorry, girls. She had nothing. She was poor, dirt poor. She had two mites to her name, as we see later on in another story. A widow came to him and said, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while. He wouldn't. Who's this lady? She's got nothing. She's got no reason. She's got no purpose. She's got no significance in life. Go away. And he would not for a while, but afterwards he said within himself, though I don't fear God or regard men, yet because this widow troubles me, I love this, yet this widow troubles me. She bugs me. I think of it like this. He's painting a picture and put it in 21st century vernacular. This little old lady, sorry, ladies, I'm not trying to be irreverent to you, but this little old lady with a little bit of spunk and a little bit of gumption and a little bit of fire to her step shows up at his door every day and says, give me justice, give me justice, give me justice. Give me justice. And he's just like, this lady's driving me nuts. Give me justice. Go away. No. Give me justice. Give me justice. I don't care about you. Go away. No. Till finally this judge, this corrupted judge says, this lady is bugging me so much that I'll just give her justice to get her out of my hair. What a parable that Jesus says, this is what you should be like. That you should be so tenacious in life. That you should be a bulldog to the promises of God. That you see afar off God's plan and God's purpose, and there's a potential in your life for God to do something in you and through you. But yet not just say, God, I sit and wait for it. But to say, God, give it to me, 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 give it to me. God, give it to me. I need it. 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 God, would you do it? Would you do it? God, would you do it? God, would you do it? But then beyond that, to do something about it. To do something about it. I think as a Christian, just as a Christian, for me, the hardest and the most sobering reality that I found in God is that God is not moved by my needs. That's tough. Because I have this image of God as this father figure who wants me to have everything. As a dad to my five-year-old and four-year-old, I want him to have everything. They ask me for it, and it's kind of like, yeah, I want you to have it. But yet, just like a father, I know that they shouldn't have everything they want. Because I know that it's not going to do them good to have everything they want. And I cry out to God for the needs in my life. God, I need. God, I need you. God, I need you. But yet God's not moved by my need. He's moved by my faith. And that's probably one of the hardest, and I say most sobering realities that we come to grips with as Christians, as followers of God. Because it seems almost cruel that God, who cares for us beyond all, who knows every hair on our head, who knows us from our beginning to our end, who knows how the end of our life will be just as much as he knows how the beginning of our life was, who knew us as he formed us in the wombs of our mother, how he could see my need and not respond to that. But yet, it's my faith that God has moved by. You see, it was Abraham's faith that God was moved by. It was Joseph's faith that moved God when he was locked up in prison, wrongly accused by his brothers and by Potiphar's wife, and when his life was going to hell in a handbasket. It wasn't David's needs as he was hiding in a cave from a king who wanted to kill him. It was David's faith that God was going to do something and that David would pursue God. You see, it wasn't the widow's need that moved the judge. It was her persistence. In the Bible, there was a starving widow. It wasn't her need that she was about to die that was moving God. It was her faith to respond to God's instruction. And God sees our needs and he knows our needs. As a matter of fact, he knows your needs more than you know your needs. And thus he's not moved by them. What he is moved by is your faith. But the challenge I have today as I bring it to you tonight, what just God simply put on my heart, is our faith is not simply sitting back waiting for God to do something. Our faith is stepping out and believing that God's gonna do something. Because ultimately, the story of the conquest, the promised land, is a dissatisfactory ending. It's kind of a letdown. It doesn't end all that great. See, they go through and they spy out the land and they find out what their inheritance is. And the next book in the Bible, Judges chapter 1, goes through the tribes of Israel, the family groups of Israel, one by one. One by one, you know what it says? Benjamin did not fully possess the land. The family of Joseph did not fully possess the land. Manasseh did not fully possess the land. Judah did not fully possess the land. Simeon did not fully possess the land. Naphtali did not fully possess the land. The people of Dan the family of Dan, not Pastor Dan, this is the tribe of Israel, the family of Dan, they didn't fully possess the land. You see, really, ultimately, it's a story of unfulfilled potential. It's a story of God saying, I had so much for you, but you never stepped out to really reach that potential. And you know the sad part about the story is this great leader, Joshua, this great leader, Caleb, Elijah named his firstborn son after him, I think, right? These dynamic leaders of these people, you know what happens at the end of the story? They die. And his generation dies. And the Bible tells us in Judges chapter 1 that the next generation grew up not knowing God and what God had done for his people. And they were pestered by the people that they never conquered. They became a thorn in their side through the course of the entire history, today remaining. Unfulfilled potential. And so we sit back and we say, God, I see potential in your promise, and I need you to move on my behalf. But my question is, what are you doing to find the potential in God's promises? Because Joshua said to these people, he warned them. God, through his spirit, spoke to Joshua, challenge my people. How long will you live your life in unfulfilled potential? Because that's not what I want for you. And Jesus simply says in of our lives, there's a lot of things we seek after to make us happy, right? We seek after what's going to make us happy, what's going to make us feel good, what's going to make us fit in, what's going to make us belong, what hobbies are going to give us that relaxation and that rest, what TV shows are going to let me just check out from work and the pressures of life, and what are the things that I can do to make my life better? We do a lot of seeking. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Jesus says this. He says, seek the kingdom of God first and his righteousness. All these things. What are all these things? What will I eat? What shall I drink? What will I wear? People were concerned about their fashion just as much as you are. Every day you wake up and say, is this going to work on me or not? He says, beside all that, he says, seek me. Seek me. Chase me. Get off the rock that you're sitting on in life, waiting for your promises to come to you. Come after me. And all of these things, I like to think of it like this. All of the potential of what could be in your life will come to you if you just chase me. And that's just what I want to tell you today. I don't have points. I don't have talking points or statements. Jesus says, seek me. One of the quotes that we love at the church, and I stand on it as a promise of God. Solomon, David's son, who built the very first temple in which was the permanent dwelling place of God to his people. Solomon built this grand temple, this grand place. It was a massive, massive effort for the people of Israel, and it cost them a lot of money. Cost them a lot of time, cost them a lot of effort. And as he was building this temple, this psalm came out of it, Psalms 127, in verse number 1. We quote the first part of that here at the Rock because we believe in it. It's a song of Solomon. It says, unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. I think what happens in my own life and maybe even in yours is we stand on the first part of that. That God's got to build the house. God's got to fulfill his promises. God's got to show up in my life because without God, I can't do nothing. You know what I'm talking about? But you see, there's an equal side of responsibility in this verse. It says, unless God builds those who, what? Labor. Labor in vain. You see, you just don't see it in the heart of God to sit back and casually just wait for God to do something great and mighty in our lives. Today, what are you waiting on God for? What are you waiting on God for? What is it that God wants to do in your life? What is it that God wants to do through you? What is the potential that God wants to bring you to? And then the question I ask is, what are you doing to chase that? We sit back and say, God, I need blessings in my life. God, I need you to prosper me financially. I'm in a pit right now, and I need to get out of this pit. What are you doing? Are you changing your spending habits? Are you working to be a good steward of what little you have right now? God, I need you to work on my kids. They're just a disaster. They're a hot mess right now. What are you doing to chase that potential? I mean, are you investing in them? Are you like this persistent widow on your knees every day, praying, seeking after God, speaking the word of God over them? God, I need you. I need you to move into my life. I need you to make a change in my heart. I'm tired of being who I am, and I want to get to this next place in my life. What are you doing to chase that potential and that promise that God says, I want to take you somewhere. I want to bring a change in your life. I want to develop you in a greater capacity. But you got to seek me. You got to dig into your word. You got to chase me just like I chase you. Because Joshua foretold this. He said, guys, how long are you going to wait until the potential is unfulfilled in your life? It's a story of unfulfilled potential. Kind of a downer. But here's what I think is cool. Is all throughout the New Testament, Jesus says, there's a bunch of people that shocked him. A couple of weeks ago, Pastor Jim talked about it. We call her the Syrophoenician woman. That's kind of a crazy name, right? She came and asked Jesus for healing for her daughter. And Jesus said, I'm not nothing for you. I'm not here for you. I'm here for the children of Israel. And she came back and she said, yep, but I'll take a crumb. I'll take a crumb off the table. Jesus, I don't need the whole dinner. I'll just take a crumb. And she came back. She didn't take no. She was like that persistent widow. And Jesus marveled. He marveled. And he said, this is nuts. I don't even see this in the people I'm here for. There was a centurion, a Roman, but they hated the Romans. And this Roman comes to Jesus and he's coming on behalf of his servant. And he says, Jesus, my servant is sick. And Jesus does the craziest thing, totally illegal. Jesus says, I'll go to your house. Not okay to the Jews. Not okay. Just not okay. Imagine your biggest mortal enemy coming to you and saying, I need your help to help me move furniture. And that's like you saying, okay. And Jesus says, I'll come to your house. And the centurion says, stop. You don't need to do that. All you need to do is just say something and he'll be healed. And Jesus, I'd just like to take a moment and think about that. Jesus just marvels. He goes, I think he took a step back and just went, and Capernaum, and he just went, this guy gets it. This guy gets it. He turns to all his followers and he says, I've not seen faith like this in any of you. This guy got it. He went down in the history books of the Bible as a man of great faith. See, the story of your life isn't finished. It's being written as we speak. The story of my life isn't finished. It's being written as we speak. And there's so much potential in your walk with God and what God wants to do for your life. There's so much that God wants to do. And I think of it like this. I think that there's one of two things that can happen. It could be a story at the end of your life where you might find yourself with God and you might say, hey, you know what? Well done, my good and faithful servant. You did all right. Welcome into my kingdom. But then he might show you the unfulfilled potential in your life. To say, you did okay, but man, you were 0.02% away from graduating with honors. Or the story of your life could be the story of great faith. That when you stand before God someday at the end of your life, that Jesus takes a step back and he says, God, man, I didn't see faith like you had. In all of the inland empire. And the place where people go to lose hope, I couldn't find faith like you had. I think that's the potential that God wants this house to get to. A story of great faith. A story that says, you know what? It's going to cost me dearly in my life to fulfill God's promises. It might very well be easier to not fulfill God's promises. But I want my story to not be a story of unfulfilled potential. But I want my story to be a story of great faith. And Jesus says this. Jesus says this. In Luke, the 18th chapter, we were there. Maybe you're still there if you kept your Bible open. The very end of this parable, he talks about if the wicked judge will respond, how much more will God respond to you? But then he asks this question of the second half of the last verse of this parable. In verse number 8, Jesus says this. He says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man, and that's his name for him, nevertheless, when I come, will I really find faith on earth? What a challenge. What a challenge that is to you and to me. That Jesus asks this question that the historian Luke wrote down. The question is, when I come back, will I really find faith? Will you really be the one known to step out to the unknown, to chase the potential of my promises down? Or will you sit by on a rock and wait for life to pass you by? Let it not be said of that, of you. I don't want that for you. My life's purpose is for us to recognize God's potential in your life and your potential in the kingdom of God. If nothing else happens in my life and somebody gets that, that's it. That's it. I think we should be people of great faith. If you're standing on the promise of God, you're waiting on something. You say, you know what? I want to step out. I want to take a step, but I don't know where to start. Would you stand? Can we pray together? Every one of you is going to have a different starting line. You're going to have a different place in life to start. There's not a, here's point A for you. You might be on point C in your journey. But I'm going to ask God tonight to move on us. You know one thing the disciples prayed for? They didn't pray for God to give them money. They didn't pray for God to fix all their problems, and they were dealing with a lot of persecution, and they were being locked up in prisons, and their friends were dying all over the place. And you know what they prayed for? It was a super crazy prayer. They prayed for boldness. To step out and to reach the potential that God challenged them with, to spread his word in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and all the world. They said, God, would you give us boldness to step out, to recognize, to realize, and to fulfill the potentials of your promise? Let's pray for boldness tonight. Would you just go before the presence of God? You can lift your hands to God if you'd like. Close your eyes, bow your heads, whatever you want to do. But let's just take a moment with God. Lord, in this place tonight, I felt your calling. I felt your invitation. I see people all over this place that have just had a unique touch, and it's just a different night. Lord, I pray for boldness in this house. I pray for boldness in these people in our lives, every one of us who want to step out beyond our comfort zone, who might look at the promises that we're waiting on and see that there is a cost in our lives associated with these promises. And God, I pray that we wouldn't be timid of these promises, that we wouldn't be fearful of that cost, that we wouldn't be comfortable in our present life, but Lord, that we would look at that and we would say, I want with all of my heart, with all of my life, to chase the potential and the reality and the realization of your promises in my life. So God, every person that's in this place today that's standing in faith for something to happen in their lives, God, I pray for one and first and foremost, you would speak to them a word of encouragement with your Holy Spirit tonight, in their spirit, in the depths of their soul, somewhere in their lives, that you would drop into their hearts your will, your desire, and your pleasure for them and your passion for them. Lord, I pray that as they seek after you, that all these things that we look about would fall into place. And Lord, I pray that as we seek after you, that you would give us the divine steps in which we are to take in order to chase our potential in your promises. That we would take a step of faith every day to realize fully what you have for our lives. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. 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 There are many of you up here tonight just wanting a move from God, a touch from God in your heart and in your life. And we're going to take a moment and pray. But specifically up here and even back there, there are those of you that there's a distance in your heart between you and God, and you want to close that distance with a relationship that's meaningful, that's real, that's powerful, that's beyond religion, that's beyond tradition. There's just something pulling you deeper with God. I want to call it a commitment to Jesus, perhaps a rededication of your commitment to Jesus. But if that's you in this place, I'm going to ask them if you'd just sing one more line. If that's you in this place today, I want to extend that invitation. Would you come and would you join me as we pray together to commit to Jesus, to commit to ask God to do something great into your life, to bring fulfillment into your life that you've never experienced yet before. Would you join me up here to make a commitment to surrender your life to Jesus like we're singing today, to respond to God's invitation into your heart to a deeper and meaningful life with His Son, Jesus Christ. Would you respond? I just want to give one more invitation. Would you just sing it? Just one line or two lines of that. I just feel a sweet presence of God moving in our hearts all across this auditorium for various things. And in a moment, we're going to pray for God's move on our own lives. But right now, I want to address specifically those who are at a distance with God. You're not sure of your place or position with God. You feel empty and questioning where you are with God. If that's you, would you do something, especially for those of you that are up here today? Would you just press forward, because I want to know you. I want to acknowledge you. I want to look at you in your eyes. And if that's you, would you just come up? Would you just press? If you're in the back of the crowd, would you just press up? I want to know who you are. If you're here for just a touch from God, that's so good. That's so great. We're going to do that. But would you give the people space to just say, I'm making a commitment to Jesus today. That's what I'm here for right now. If that's you, just press in to God. He's pursuing you, and I love His promise that says, if you pursue Him, He'll pursue you. He'll meet you right where you're at today. And would you just do this, because I just want to know. Jesus says these words that if you'd confess Him before men, He'd confess you before God. And I want to know, because I know that there are some, I recognize some of you, and maybe you're making a commitment and a rededication in your life. But for those of you up here right now, you're saying, I'm here right now, Pastor Luke, because I want to give my life to Jesus. Would you just
wave your hand at me so I know you, so I can look at you, so I can say, hey, man, look at you. You're doing so good. Look at you guys. Yeah. If that's you, just give me a little wave. Give me a little something. Look at you. Yeah. Yeah. You see, you're walking miracles right now because I can't explain it. You can't explain it. I didn't say anything. I didn't manipulate or coerce you. It's just the straight divine power of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Chasing you. Can you imagine, just before we pray, I just want to blow your noodle for a minute, okay? Can I just bake your noodle for just a minute? Can you imagine that the God who created the universe, I mean, when you think about the expanse of the skies, and when you think about the size of Earth, and when you think about all the scientific wonders that we found out on in this day and age of how miraculous it is that we're here, and the one that holds that all in the palm of his hand took a divine moment in a service that you attended, maybe by chance, by coincidence, to pursue you personally. I mean, it doesn't make any sense, but God values you that much to say, I'm going to chase you. Not just you chase me, I'm going to chase you. I'm going to come after you, and I'm going to draw you, and I'm going to bring you. And I just don't want you to forget this moment. We're going to pray together. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer. And I just don't want you to get wrapped up in a moment of religion or anything like that. And understand that God didn't chase you to fulfill a tradition, to say some formula and everything's good. God chased you for your heart. And you responded because you felt that. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer today. And I'm going to ask you just to repeat some words after me. And I want you to use your heart. I want you to not make them my words, but make them your words out of your heart as you believe them. And you use your mouth to repeat them. And I believe God's going to do something amazing in your life. That's something you've not seen, something that you've not experienced. I believe he's going to take you somewhere completely different that you've ever seen. So let's just do this. Would you do this with me? Those of you who are up here who are wanting to give your life or rededicate your life, and even those back there, that's you in this place today. Maybe you're at home watching online on the live stream. If that's you, we're going to pray this prayer, and I'm going to just ask everybody to repeat this prayer after me. But particularly those who you raised your hand, you looked at me in the eye, and I looked at you. I want you to pray this prayer with your heart. Let's go before God, and let's let God do a great thing in our lives. Would you all do this? Well, let's pray together. Let's all bow our heads today in this place and repeat these words after me. God, I come to you today, and I felt your presence. I felt your calling. I felt your invitation. And I'm here today to respond to this moment. Today, I give my life to you. I don't know fully what that might mean, but this moment today, I make a commitment to dedicate my life to Jesus Christ. I ask that you forgive me of my past. I make a commitment to turn away from my sins. And I give my future to you. Have your way in my life. You are my life. From this day forward, I'll follow you. Fill me with your spirit. Fill me with your love. Speak to me in my heart. Your goodness and grace towards me. From this moment forward, I'll follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Father, we come today. Many of us are wanderers in life, but Lord, I pray is that you draw us close to you. God, that we would just sense your presence beyond this moment. God, that we would sense your presence as we walk out of this service tonight. Lord, that we would sense your very presence in our lives as we're about our day tomorrow and the next day. Lord, many of us who carry heavy weights and burdens of hurt and of experiences of past, God, as we lay them at your feet, Lord, we just say, God, take these from us and carry us on your wings, Lord. Carry us into your levels, Lord. Take us to where you want us to go, Lord. We just come with open hearts tonight to receive of your presence, to receive of your healing. The healing presence of God is in this place tonight. And Lord, we just, receive that healing tonight, God. We receive that restoration in our hearts. We receive that peace that we need and we've longed for, God. We just reach out and we say, God, we receive that from you. We receive that from you, and we give you a praise tonight that you're worthy of. And we thank you, God, for what you've done. Lord, we thank you what you're doing. Lord, we thank you what you will do in our lives as we look forward to you and to Jesus. Can we just lift up a voice of praise tonight to Jesus in this house? Jesus, we love you, God. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your peace and your presence in Jesus' name. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Well, I tell you, it's so good to be here. It's a place of healing tonight. It's a place of healing tonight. God's doing his hospital work in your life right now. And I tell you, it's just beginning. It's just beginning. For those of you tonight that you've rededicated your heart, you've made a commitment to say, you know what, I want to follow God. We want to equip you to set off on this journey on the right foot, on the right path. And we've got some things that we want to do. Particularly, we want to just take a moment and just encourage you and pray with you if you need some prayer. And I have a friend right over here. See him waving at you right over here in this really cool motorcycle jacket. His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's got to be one of the coolest guys here. I'm serious. He just wants to take you right over there. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to pray with you. He's going to give you some information, some literature that we have to help point you in the right direction on this journey, this commitment to Jesus that you're making to say, hey, this is where I'm going to go. He's going to invite you to come back. We want to equip you. So if that's you, if you made that decision, don't go back to your seat just yet. We're going to be here. We're not leaving. You won't come out and everybody's gone. I promise. We'll all be here still. But if you would just turn to your right, my left, go right over here with my friend, Pastor Joel. If that's you, if you made that choice today, would you do that? Let's praise God in the house.